said, amen. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God. This morning when I rose, yeah, I didn't have no doubt. Hallelujah. Welcome to Bethel Church here in the city of Stamford, in the state of Connecticut. We welcome you again, all of our virtual worshipers, everyone from far and from near. Welcome to another Sunday morning worship encounter. Amen. Today is Sunday, September the 27th, 2020. This is the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. Amen. We invite you now to take this moment to share, to like, amen, to host watch parties, to text a family, a friend, email them, tell them Bethel Church is live, and we're excited again to enter another worship experience. Amen. We welcome you, we welcome you, and we welcome you. Amen. Today we celebrate our 125th church anniversary. We will be celebrating all year for the rest of the year, for the months of September, October, November, and December. And so we are grateful that we're able to share in this the Lord's Day. Amen. Our 125th church anniversary. We're excited. We're going to hear some old but goodies, oldie but goodies in reference to our song selection this morning. Again, we Facebook, we don't own the rights to any of this music that we're sharing this Sunday morning. Again, we heard from the Mississippi Mass Choir this morning when I rose. Amen. And so thank God for being able to use what we've heard down through the years to inspire us as we celebrate this the Lord's Day. Amen. So welcome again, all of our worshipers. We praise God for you. We'll be blessed now, amen, to lead us in song titled Down Through the Years. The Lord's been good to me. How many can testify that 125 years, certainly our testimony is that down through the years, the Lord has been good to us. And this time, Reverend Jasper Williams Jr., featuring the Salem Bible Church Mass Choir, will lead us in Down Through the Years, the Lord has been good to us. Amen. Come on, put your blessed hands together right where you are, and we celebrate this the Lord's Day. Amen.
I thought I'd go back some of my old time way. And I hope this has been articulated. How good God is. Let's do it again.
Oh,
You've already done enough in these 125 years old. God, we say thank you. Thank you for blessing every organization of this church. Thank you for blessing every pastor that has served at this church. Thank you for blessing every member that has served and has transitioned now from labor to reward. God, we say thank you, Holy Ghost, for sending your comforter, God, that when we went through those moments of uncertainty, God, we thank you that you brought us out, God, even better than what we came in. So now, God, we pray now for those who are sick and shut in. We thank you, God, for those who are hospitalized. We pray now, blessing those again who are in the nursing facilities, God, that you might touch and heal their body. Thank you, God, even for those who are in the prison walls, God, that you might reach out to them and let them know, God, that you'll never leave them nor forsake them. God, we thank you for all that you will do in this worship encounter. Bless those who are watching us, God, for whatever they stand in need of. We pray now that you would meet them at the very need. God, we thank you for those who will watch even in the days to come, God. And we thank you to go, God, for this, again, this empty sanctuary, God, but for this Holy Ghost power that is ever more present, God, that it might reach those from far and near, God, that, again, lives might be transformed. Now, God, bless us, God, as we share this preached word today, that it might continue to encourage the hearts, minds of your people. Bless us now. We thank you, God. We're calling on you because we know no other name to call. God, we know that you're indeed awesome. You're indeed worthy of our praise. So, God, now let us forget about ourselves, that we might concentrate on you. Forget about our bills for the next few moments as we might hear these songs that are sung and God hear the preach. Let us forget about all those problems and issues of what we have and what we don't have. But now let's just center ourselves on you, God, that we might hear from heaven. Bless us now. Forgive us collectively of our sin that we've committed over by thought, word, and deed. And now, God, create us a clean heart, renewing us a right kind of spirit to worship you this day. Bless us now and keep us, for it's in Jesus' name we do pray. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We're grateful to our God. Amen. Our scripture reference this morning is Psalm 124. Psalm 124, again, this fits us for this moment of certainly where we share in church anniversary celebration. This fits us. This has our name, Bethel, written all on this particular psalm here, Psalm 124. And I want to read its entirety. Again, Psalm 124, reading in its entirety. This is what it says again. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel say, if the Lord had not been on our side when men attacked us, when their anger flared against us, they would have swallowed us alive. The flood would have engulfed us. The torrent would have swept over us. The raging waters would have swept us away. Praise be to the Lord, who has not let us be torn by their teeth. We have escaped like a bird out of the fowler's snare. The snare has been broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Can I just, I know it's not what we're supposed to do when we read the scripture, but can I just go back to verse 8? Our help. Somebody ought to say our help. Matter of fact, can we make this personal this Sunday morning and says Bethel's help, Bethel's help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and in earth. This is the word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to our God. Hallelujah. We're excited for being able to share another Sunday morning. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Again, we welcome all of you. We welcome, again, those who are watching us from far, from near. Again, this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We're thankful this morning that we, even with the little bit of glitches that we had on Facebook this morning, we thank God for still being able to come back quickly and to log back home. So thank you for your patience this morning. We are even now been able to stream to our website. So please go check BethelStanford.org website so to see that we are streaming. And give us some feedback in reference to the sound or also into the quality of the picture. We're trying, again, to make sure we continue to give the best service that we can through through our means of internet and various ways to see us live. Again, we're thankful for Facebook Live for being able to share. We do not own any of the songs that we have played thus far that we will play in the future. Again, and we thank God for you all being able to let us continue to stream. Amen. We're excited again. This is the third, again, this is our third sermon on this preaching series. We're excited, but certainly we welcome all of you. Listen, I want to invite you again this coming Wednesday. Every Wednesday we're here at the Word via, again, Facebook Live, also streaming Facebook, streaming also our website. We'll also be able to stream in a couple more weeks, hopefully from Zoom. Amen. And so we're in a study, how to deal with grief. This will be our third week of dealing with that study. We will have probably for several months, we will go through the stages of grief to help us as a church to kind of deal with what we have certainly experienced here at Bethel Church. And so it has been a blessing. So we invite you to come every Wednesday from 6:30 to 7:30 as we continue to understand grief and deal with it. The last title of the meditation that we dealt with is Going Crazy. And so we share a little bit about that. So it's exciting. So please come with us this coming Wednesday. Again, we heard that, as I said, and you've heard me say it over the last few weeks, this is our 125th church anniversary. We are excited. We encourage you to go back after this broadcast is over to look at the video presentations. We found some pictures here at the church. So because of our creative team that we have here, awesome secretary, we were able to coordinate and put together an awesome presentation along with some songs. And so we invite you that in the next several months to send pictures in so that way we might continue to put a video together for the next several months, pictures that you might have of you that from way back in the day, or pictures of the old Bethel. We want to incorporate those as well. And so please, after the broadcast is over, go back and look at our video presentation today as we celebrate 125 years. We'll be asking you all something very special in the near future, and that is to send in, well, I should share it now, send in a video giving congratulatory notices to, again, the Bethel Church. So we'll let you know, and I got to be mindful that when I'm talking, I got to act like I got a church full, so when we do get back, I won't forget, rather, as to what to do. Amen. Let the church say amen. So we're excited. But listen, I want to also invite you for the first time, and I've been praying about it, I've been asking God when we could possibly do this, but we're going to try it this Sunday. Listen, this is what we're going to do for our Holy Communion first Sunday. We're going to be in the parking lot worship. Somebody say amen. Parking lot worship. We ask that you would stay in your car. You don't have to get out. Parking lot worship. We're going to be making sure we're practicing social distances, but we're going to be able to do a drive-in worship experience. Amen. We're working on it now to be able to get the radio tuned into what we're going to be saying. That way you can hear through your radio if you have the capability when your car is off. And so please, again, take note of your emails and your phone calls in the next couple of days to really give you more guidelines as to what we will do on next Sunday. I'm so excited. I'm going to be outside preaching as we did almost. My Facebook reminder came out today that this time last year we were in the park at Jackie Robinson Park under the tent worshiping God. And so we're going to go forth and try this drive-in worship experience. Amen. Next Sunday at 10:30. We will also continue to do our 12:30 next Sunday as well. Those members who do not feel comfortable in the drive-in. Amen? And so come on, drive in, tell a friend. We're going to be back at Bethel Church next Sunday, 10:30, drive-in worship service so we can partake of the Lord's Supper together and at least see each other from a distance. Let the church say amen. We're excited again to each of you for your grateful for your tithes and your offerings and all that you continue to do to make this ministry what it is. Again, it takes money to do ministry. I want to thank you for your faithfulness through those who have been giving through Givelify, those who have been giving through your mail-in, as well as the drop-off here. Thank you so much. We're here again Tuesday through Friday from 10 to 3, and Sundays from 10 to 12 to 2, excuse me, from 12 to 2 on Sunday. So we're excited about that. Thank you so much. how you continue to bless us through your giving. I want to thank you also for, I know it was a late notice this past week, but we had our quarterly conference, and I want to thank you for those who were on the Zoom call with our elder as we reported the work of the church for the last two quarters. We did the first and second quarter on Zoom this past Thursday, so thank you so much. Again, we encourage you that when we have another quarter, that as many people, and I will try definitely to get the information out to you sooner, so that way we can know, we can see you all faces as we get to the point of quarterly conference. Amen. Thank you so much for all that you do and we have done over the course of this year. Listen, we're almost at the 10th month of this new of 2020. Amen. God is good. And even in the pandemic, he's kept us. And we're already in a few more days, we'll be transitioning to the month of October. Amen. But for the remaining days in September, we want to wish again happy birthday to all the September babies. I know tomorrow we have two, Vivian McCain. Vivian, she's not, again, little Vivian, as I remember some almost 5 years ago, but now Vivian is doing well in school. I just talked to her father the other day, doing well in school, and her birthday is tomorrow. So Brother McCain and others, let's tell Vivian happy birthday. Not only is Vivian celebrating a birthday, but also my second son, Malachi, DeAndre Jackson, is celebrating a birthday. Vivian and Malachi have the same birthdays. Again, he will be 15 on tomorrow. Let the church say amen. 15 on tomorrow. We thank God for him. Amen. Thank God again for all the anniversaries. God bless you all. And may heaven continue to bless your marriage and your union. Amen. Well, we're prepared now to hear a word. We're going to be blessed by, again, the Kurt Carr Singers. We do not own the rights to this music. I continuously say that because I don't want any interruption to take place while we're broadcasting live. Amen. And so this is the Kurt Carr Singers, and they will be singing and blessing us, preparing for the word, for every mountain. Let the church say amen. For every mountain. He brought us over every valley. He brought us through. We can certainly testify again that God has brought us through every situation, every transition of these 125 years. So come on, Kurt Carr Singers, bless us as we prepare to hear word from heaven.
Oh,
And the people of God said, amen. Hallelujah. We give God praise for every mountain that he brought us over, every valley he has seen us through. And for this, we give him praise. Come on, where you are, put your blessed hands together as we give God praise for this opportunity again today to say to the Lord, thank you for bringing us over. Thank you for seeing us through. When nobody, again, would help us, and when nobody would come to our rescue, and again, when people turned their backs on us, even as far as from the inception of this great Zion, this great church, God seen us through. When we look back even in the AME church and saw that in 1787, and again, when they walked out of the Bethel, the George St. George's Church in Philadelphia, God seen us through. He brought us over. When we think about 1816, we can say, certainly God brought us over. He brought us through. And because of him bringing us through, here we are today able to celebrate 125 years. We give God praise for the AME Church, again, that was founded, again, the First General Conference in 1816, and again, walked out of St. George's Church in 1787, so we give God praise for that. Amen. Hallelujah. 1787, we give God praise, and 1816, we give God praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us now prepare to draw our attention to the reading of God's word, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, I want to invite your attention to 2 Timothy, the first chapter. 2 Timothy, the first chapter, verses 1 through 12. 2 Timothy, the first chapter, verses 1 through 12, reading from the New Living Translation of the Bible. Amen. Hallelujah. Again, 2 Timothy, first chapter, verses 1 through 12. Verses 1 through 12. And here you will find these words. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus. I have been sent out to tell others about the life he has promised through faith in Christ Jesus. I'm writing to Timothy, my dear son. May God the Father, Christ Jesus, our Lord, give you grace, mercy, and peace. Encouragement to be faithful. Timothy, I thank God for you, the God I serve with a clear conscience, just as my ancestors did. Night and day, I constantly remember you in my prayers. I long to see you again, for I remember your tears as we parted. And I will be filled with joy when we are together again. Verse 5, I remember your genuine faith. Genuine faith where you share the faith that first filled your grandmother Lewis and your mother Eunice. And I know that the same faith continues strong in you. This is why I remind you to fan into the flames the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid my hands on you. Verse 7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear and timid, but of power, love, and self-discipline. So never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord. And don't be ashamed of me either, even though I'm in prison for him. When the strength God gives you, be ready to suffer with me for the sake of the good news. For God saved us and called us to live a holy life. He did this not because we deserved it, but because that was his plan from before the beginning of time to show us his grace through Christ Jesus. And verse 10, and now he has made all this plan to us by the appearing of Christ Jesus, our Savior. He broke the power of death and illuminated the way to life and immortality through the good news. Verse 11 says, and God chose me to be a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of this good news. Verse 12, this is why I am suffering here in prison. But I'm not ashamed of it, for I know the one in whom I trust. And I'm sure that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until the day of his return. I want to go back to verse 6 and 7. This is why I remind you to fan into flame the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid my hands on you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timid, but of power, love, and self-discipline. This is the word of God to the people of God. Thanks be to our God. Let us pray. God, we thank you now for this opportunity to share. We thank you for blessing us. We thank you for hearing our prayer. God, we thank you for bringing us one more time safely to this hour of worship. Now, God, have your way to do what you can only do. Bless, heal, and deliver, and set free. Now, God, forgive me for all of my sin that I committed, my thought, word, and deed. And now, God, created me a clean heart, renewing me a right kind of spirit. Preach this your word. Now, God, bless this food and be a spiritual blessing, spiritual nourishment to our bodies. In Jesus' name we do pray, and the people of God said, amen. I want to preach again and conclude this series entitled, I'm Pregnant. Part 3, I'm Pregnant. Come on, tap yourself again and declare with me for one last time, I'm pregnant, I'm pregnant, I'm pregnant, I'm pregnant, I'm pregnant, I'm pregnant. Again, today we conclude this three-part series entitled, I'm Pregnant. And for the last 2 weeks, we have compared the physical birth to a spiritual birth, looking at the first and second trimesters. Throughout this spiritual pregnancy, let me again remind you that we're not speaking in terms of babies. Rather, we are speaking in terms of birthing some spiritual gifts. Last week, we focused on what spiritual gifts are, and according to chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, Paul explained the concept of spiritual gifts. He declared that each person had a gift given through the Holy Spirit. At conversion, as you remember, we shared that at conversion, all of us who confess with our mouths and believe in our hearts are given a spiritual gift. Sometimes it takes us longer to actually realize what the gift that God has placed in us. But the Bible says that at conversion, all of us have a gift from God. Brothers and sisters, the purpose of the gift is, again, as you remember, was for the common good. Somebody shout common good. Let me press pause already in the beginning of my introduction, because you went up and turned the stove off. Listen, I said, all of us are given, again, spiritual gifts for the common good of the church. Let me say it again, 3 times the charm. Thank you, choir. Again, all of us at conversion are given spiritual gifts for the common good of the church. Listen, I want to place special emphasis on common good, because so often we get a gift from God and we think it's all about us. We get a gift from God, we can do some things that nobody else can do, and they think it's all about you, that if you don't show up, it won't get done. If you're not the chairperson, it won't be a success. You know how it is that we think God blessed us, endowed us with some gifts, and we think we're the only one that can do it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. But the Bible says, for the common good. The common good. Simply put, we have all we have to offer it to God, the ability that God has blessed us with, so that we can make not you better, but the body of Christ better. Lord, help us here. So today, Bethel, we're in this third trimester of pregnancy, which consists of weeks 28 through 42, the labor and the birth. Listen, we went through all the first two trimesters, and it's a great thing to be able to see and feel the baby kicking. It's a great thing to be able to see again all the elements, all the functionalities of a sonogram. But now we're at a stage where we're ready to deliver. Somebody say, I'm ready to deliver. Yeah, we're at a stage of going through all the pains, all the kicks. But now God is now centering us, now preparing us to give a spiritual birth. Lord, help us here. And so, Bethel, as we look at, as we again look at delivering our gifts to the spiritual pregnancy, who else better to call on to offer some words of encouragement other than the apostle I said, whoever else to call as we help deliver again these spiritual gifts. And that the Apostle Paul himself, listen, in our text we see Timothy. Somebody shout Timothy. Yeah. The Apostle Paul's young protege. Paul sent Timothy to try to recover a mess in the church of Ephesus. Yeah. And yet when Timothy got there, he found himself in way over his head. In research, you'll see that the entire leadership team in Ephesus and the Ephesian church was older than he was, and they didn't respect his leadership. Yeah. And to make matters worse, Timothy was shy and Timothy was timid, and so he had a tendency to avoid confrontation. Can I just pause here and tell somebody, no matter how young you are, if God placed you in a position of leadership, you ought to leave. No matter if everybody who presides over is older than you, no, don't let that worry about a thing. No, if God puts you in that place, God has already gifted you for that assignment. I don't care how young you are, if God brought you to it, he'll bring you through it. I don't care how young you are, God has called you for such a time as this. Yeah, so Timothy, he was trying to avoid confrontation. Yeah, the stress of his ministry assignment was affecting Timothy's health. And as he found himself sick with constant stomach ailments, in the meantime, here it is, his mentor, Apostle Paul, had been arrested by the Roman government. Yeah. And so Timothy's vision had deteriorated. The excitement and enthusiasm that he once felt when he joined Paul's ministry team some years earlier had now gone. And somewhere between his poor health and his discouragement about the church in Ephesus, his fear for Paul's life, Timothy's vision had slipped away. Yeah. In other words, Timothy was on the verge of going through what I call a spiritual abortion. Yeah. And can I tell you here, that's what happens when you allow the devil to mess with your mind. You will think about it. You will have a spiritual abortion even before it comes to fruition, even before it comes into reality, because you'll let the devil talk to you out. But can I pause here for a moment and tell you to serve notice again for the second week in a row to the devil and say, devil, you have no power here. Come on, serve notice to the devil right in your house. I don't care what you're trying to do, devil, you will not get the victory. I'm going to deliver this gift if you like it or not. Come on, tell your neighbor. Matter of fact, this is the word for you. Encourage yourself right through here and say, I don't care what the devil may try to do, but I'm going to get the victory. I'm going to get the victory. Yeah, so Timothy needed, like sometimes in our spiritual walk, Timothy needed his vision renewed, and that's what Paul wrote him. That's why Paul wrote this second letter, because he needed to kind of breathe back in some life into Timothy, because he allowed the devil to distract him. And so here it is. I know this is 125 years, but here I'm on assignment today to breathe life back into you, to tell you that I know it's been difficult, I know it's been hard, but I'm going to breathe life back into you. I'm going to tell you that you can do it. I'm going to tell you that greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. You got it. Yes, you can. You got it. You can make it. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. So this second letter is the last letter we have from Paul's pen before his execution. It is considered his last will and testament as Paul reflects back on the vision that fueled his life and ministry. It also serves to renew again Timothy's vision as Paul's son in the ministry. It also provides us with a renewed hope and confidence to those of us who are spiritually pregnant. Hear the words to Timothy again. To Timothy, he says, to my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve as my forefathers did with a clear conscience as night and day. I constantly, here it is, Paul is telling Timothy, I constantly pray, have you in my prayer. I'm constantly calling on behalf of you, recalling your tears I long to see. Can I tell you, it's good to have somebody to pray for you. It's good to have somebody intercede for you. It's good to have somebody to go to God on your behalf. And so that's what, again, we find Paul telling Timothy in this second letter. He's saying, listen, Timothy, I've been praying for you. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which lived in your grandmother and in your mother. I'm persuaded that now lives in you also. For this reason, I want to remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying of my hand. For God, I don't want you to hear this again, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, but God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and a sound mind. Here it is. The Bethel, as we prepare for the delivery experience, let us be mindful of Paul's words to Timothy. Our emphasis this morning centers on verse 6, in which Paul advises Timothy to fan into flame the gift that he's received from God. Scholars over the years have debated what this gift was, and it is commonly accepted that Timothy had a gift for ministry. He was capable of starting churches and teaching and preaching and evangelizing. And Paul's message to Timothy is to fully express his gift, not holding anything back. And I'm convinced, brothers and sisters, that in our spiritual delivery room this morning, Paul's words in the text sets us up for smooth labor. Paul again admonishes Timothy to fan into flame his gift for ministry. I'm going to point out three things in the text and we're going to let you go. Here it is. First one that I want you to know in this spiritual delivery room is that you got to draw on your spiritual heritage. Come on, somebody shout. You got to draw on your spiritual heritage. Let me say it again. Draw on your spiritual heritage. Here it is. Timothy drew on his spiritual heritage. Listen, we all have a heritage. We can trace our families back to where they originated, knowing the careers they worked and the lives that they lived. Our ancestors' lives continue to shape our lives even today. Our last name bear our ancestors' mark. Even our health is connected to that of our ancestors. Our family heritage gives us a complete picture of our identity, who we are and where we came from. Likewise, as Christians, we all have a spiritual inheritance. We all have a spiritual heritage, I should say, that consists of the people that introduced us to Christ and have helped us to mature in our faith. For some, our spiritual heritage may be linked to a specific church or a minister. It may be linked or to a teacher or a friend. Or, as in Timothy's case, his spiritual heritage comes directly from his family. Here it is. Paul gives us a glimpse into Timothy's spiritual heritage. He says, I'm reminded of your sincere faith that first lived in your grandmother Lewis and in your mother Lucy. And I'm persuaded that now lives in you. Listen, can I tell you, Timothy grew up in a house of faith under his mother and grandmother. His mother and grandmother were both Jewish, while Timothy's father was a Gentile. It was his mother and grandmother who taught him about God. And in the time period of Peter, or Timothy, excuse me, it was common until the age of 7 for a Roman boy's mother to be his main formative influence up until the age of 7. And since Timothy's father was not religious, being a Gentile, it was customary that boys without a living religious father learn about the law from the grandmother if they are still living. I don't know if that I'm talking to this morning. Anybody thankful that your grandmother, your great-grandmother, your grandfather, your great-grandfather, that instilled some stuff in you that when your mother and father could not instill into you, you're grateful for your grandparents. Anybody grandparents drug you to church? Listen, I remember my grandmother rolling me in that bag of blue Buick in the Sunday school. I remember us loading up into that Buick on our way to Sunday. God for my grandma. Any witnesses that can say, thank God for my grandmother, she drove me to church. Here it is. And that's inheritance. You got an inheritance, rather. You got a heritage. You got some people that you can draw along. Here it is. And as I think about Bethel Church over these last 125 years, Bethel, you too got a spiritual heritage. You too have some people that you can look to. I thank God for 1895 when Bethel Church was organized. I thank God for Brother John Taylor. I thank God for Reverend C.P. Cole. I thank God for those pastors that have gone before us that now have paved the way. We too have a spiritual inheritance. Church, I want to encourage you that when you come back to church, whenever God gives us the green light to come back in, I want you to stroll down Bethel Sanctuary. I want you to look at every windowsill in the church sanctuary. And I want you to look at every name that's all in this sanctuary on the windows. And then I want you to look at every pew. And I want you to look at all the names that are listed on the pews. That's our spiritual heritage. That's what we ought to look to in time to get rough. Look for those who've gone before us. I hear the Bible say there's a great cloud of witnesses. And Bethel Church, I'm glad that we don't just have a fly-by-night church. We have 125 years that God has blessed us with. And thank God for the heritage. I'm feeling
pretty good right now. I'm feeling pretty good here. That not only, listen, do we got to draw on our spiritual heritage, draw on our spiritual heritage, but the second thing is that we got to develop the God-given gift inside of us. Here it is. Secondly, you got to develop the God-given gift inside of you. Come on, look at yourself and say, I got to develop the God-given gift inside of me. I got to develop the God-given gift inside of me. Here it is. In order for Timothy to fan into flame his gift of ministry, he must draw on his spiritual heritage. But he must also develop the gift that's inside of him. That's why Paul encouraged him to develop his gift in verse 6. Paul says, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. And the words fan in the flame that Paul uses here can also mean to stir up or to rekindle. The gift that God has given Timothy is like a fire. It's burning inside of him. Paul wants Timothy to develop this gift, not to waste the gift. Paul wants Timothy to intensify the fire within him. Paul wants him to be overcome with passion for this gift that God has given him and use it to the fullest potential. Paul, once again, the fire in Timothy to be extreme. He wants a cold red. He wants Timothy to develop his gift and to fan and to flame his gift to the point where through Timothy the gospel spreads and the flowers burn intensely with a passion for ministry. He once again to encourage Timothy to serve the Lord with all his might. But the Bible says again, but each man has his own gift from God. One has a gift, another one has. That's 1 Corinthians 7:7 says, but each man has his own gift from God. One has this gift, another has that. Yeah. The Bible tells us that we all have been gifted just as Timothy has been gifted. And I have a question for you this morning. Are you developing the gift inside of you? Do you know what your gift is? Listen, I've got to tell you, find out what your gifts are. Once you discover your gifts, once you discover again what's inside of you, do everything in your power to develop that gift so that you can use it, not for your glory, but for God's glory. Listen, fan into flame your gift. Make it so that it burns. And people can see the God in you. Don't waste what God has given you. No, you ought to serve in your giftedness. Now is the time to let your passion for ministry to go out. You are closer to your destiny than you think. Now is not the time to give up on what God has promised you. No, you are declaring it's coming to pass. What's inside of you is on its way out. That's why I'm glad God gave me this word for such a time as this. Yes, I know it's 125 years, and this is supposed to be the year never overflow, but can I tell you, God is still going to pour it out on us. He's still, but listen, we got to use the gift that's inside of us. We got to develop the gift. Somebody shout, develop. Develop the gift. Well, I'm about done. We haven't been too long, but I got to get to this third and final point. Here it is. This third thing I want to share with you. Not only you got to draw on your spiritual heritage, number one. Secondly, you got to develop the gift inside of you, number two. But thirdly, here it is. We got to display God's spirit of godliness. Yeah. Display God's spirit of godliness. Here it is again. I said display God's spirit of godliness. Brothers and sisters, Timothy has the gift of ministry. It was given to him by God through the laying on Paul's hands. Paul had instructed Timothy to fan into flame that gift by drawing on his spiritual heritage and developing this God-given gift. He now instructs him to display a new spirit of godliness. Timothy was known for having the spirit of being timid. He was shy and sensitive. And we already mentioned how he went when Paul had left him previously. But Paul reminds Timothy that God has given him a new spirit. He says again in the Bible, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. Yeah, brothers and sisters, you see here what it means to have power. Listen, power here is spiritual. Godliness simply means power. Timothy would have to take on more authoritative roles. Can I just tell you right here, sometimes in your giftedness, it requires you to take down authority. If God has placed you in a role, take down authority. Show some power. You can't be timid. You got to show some power. But then not only did the Bible say about spiritual godliness of having power, but it said you got to do it in love. Yes, you might have the power. Yes, you might have the time, but you got to do it in love. Everything you say, every time you make a move, make a decision, brother and sister, you ought to do it in love. I can hear Sister F saying even now, every time we met for Bible study, she will remind us to listen to that. If we got to read somebody the rights, read them the rights in love. Yes, if you got to tell them what to do, do it in love. That's what Jesus does. But not only that, the Bible said godliness means that you got to do it with a sound mind. In other words, you got to have some self-discipline. You can't be wishy-washy, wishy-washy, wishy-washy. You got to have some self-discipline. You got to be self-controlled. You got to know when to turn it on and turn it off. You got to know when to fall back. You got to know when to fold them. And you got to know when to hold them. Did y'all just hear what I said? You got to have some self-discipline. Every fight you don't have to engage in. Every battle you don't have to bring your fighting to. Sometimes you got to just lay back and chill. Sometimes you just got to let things play out. That's what we mean by self-control, self-discipline, having a sound mind. You can't win every battle. Some battle, brothers and sisters, are not for you to fight anyway. The battle is the Lord's. Stop trying to do things and say things that people of God is already working out and already fought the battle for you. Matter of fact, lay back and just chill. Well, I'm done, y'all. I'm done. I've held you too long. It's time to get out of this delivery room. Yeah, you know what the Bible says, for much room is given, much is required. You got to have some power, but you got to do it in some love. You got to have a sound mind. Don't you be scared. Don't you be scared. Enough. But here it is. I want to give this to you. And I'll conclude this sermon. I'll conclude this series. I want to just go back to the delivery room experience. Can I talk about for a few more minutes? Just give me a few more minutes. Can I talk about this delivery room experience? And therefore, even in a pandemic, God wanted me to remind you that you are still pregnant with possibilities. God wanted me to remind you that you are still pregnant with visions and dreams. Yes, brothers and sisters, even in a crisis, I still believe many in the body of Christ right now are in the place of birthing desires, promises, harvests, and mandates. Lord, help me preach here. the birthing stage we're in right now is what I call the transition. Somebody shout transition. For those of you who know anything about the natural childbirth, know that transition is the stage when the baby's head is crowding. Lord, help me preach. It means that the end is near, but it also be the stage where the mother delivering feels like she can no longer go on. She is breathless. She is tired from the hours of labor and pushing. And listen, in the natural birth, many women can have a sense of panic overtake them. This also relates to us in the transitional stage of giving birth to the promises of God. I'm coming, y'all. I'm coming. We can tend to be vulnerable and be overtaken by panic and irrational thinking, which partners with the spirit of fear. But we already read in the text that Timothy is not to have the spirit of fear, but a power of love and a sound mind. Can I tell you, beloved? Can I tell you, don't panic? You're in the delivery room, but you ought not panic. Be encouraged and be reminded that you're in the place right where God wants you to be. You're in this place because you said yes to more. Did y'all hear what I said? I said you're in the place because you said yes to more. You can see the promise in your spiritual womb, as did Sarah and Abraham. One that is out of your natural ability to form or to bring forth. You declare out of your mouth, Lord, I'm available. You said yes, Lord, in defiance of the status quo, in the pursuit of more, that you know that it's more in you than what people might conceive. And we as a people of God are in the advance forward mode right now. Now you find yourself transitioning from one place to the next, from one level to the next, from one season to the next, and it can be the most testing times of your faith, because in transition your visions can be intact. You aren't where you were, but you aren't where you used to be. The tension in this place is and stage of giving birth is intense in there. It's such temptation to let it go, to give up. That in this stage of transition, you'll have some thoughts that you might say, God, I can't do it anymore. God, this isn't for me. God, maybe I missed my calling. God, did you really say this? I feel picture now. Yes, let's forget for just a moment what the enemy told you to do. But now let's concentrate on what God has told you to do. Yes, you can hear yourself try to say, I can't do it. I'm not the one. But can I tell you, you are the one. You're just in transition. I can see the birth happening now. And can I be very honest and transparent? My wife, I said my wife gave birth 4 times. And all 4 times were all natural births. She did not receive any epidural for pain relief. But every single time when we got at that moment of transition, about to deliver all of my 4 handsome sons, my wife would look at me and she would say, I can't do it. I can't do it no more. Every delivery that she had, she uttered those words, I can't do it. But yet in this stage, your mind fails you. Your strength leaves you. But there's something in your body that does just what the mind cannot do. It continues to contract to push the baby out. Yes, you ought to yield to contractions and let the process of transition bring forth the baby that's inside of you. Can I tell you that every time you want to give up, you ought to declare to yourself, say, self, yes, I can. Self, yes, I can. You ought to encourage yourself and say, if God said it, I believe it. It's mine. If God said it, I'm going to start that business. I know it's tough now, but if God said it, it will come to pass. I said, if God You can take it to the bank. Yeah, goodbye, y'all. I held you too long. But you're in transition. You're right at the stage that God is about to birth you. Something inside of you. And I'm going to leave you now. But I hear the old song says, I'm standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through the eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory, glory in the highest. I will shout and sing. Shout yes, shout yes. I'm getting ready, getting ready, getting ready. Come on, tap yourself and say, I'm getting ready to deliver what's inside of me. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready. I'm getting ready to deliver what's inside of me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm getting ready to deliver what's inside of me. Brothers and sisters, here it is. I know I'm done. I know you're in transition stage. I've all you prayed for. All you have fasted for, and all you have walked the floors at night, it seems like God is not hearing you. But I want to encourage you and tell you that you're just in the transition stage, preparing for what's to come. I want to leave you with these closing points, and it's the invitation to let you go. My wife and two out of four children that we're blessed to have, two of my sons did not make it. In terms of did not make it, did not come forth when the doctor was there. My wife shared with the nurses and staff that I deliver quickly. I deliver quickly. And the doctors took for granted what she said. And two out of four of my sons, they came into this world, not in the hands of doctors, but in the hands of nurses. And can I tell you, brothers and sisters, no one knows when you're going to deliver. Only God knows when your spiritual gifts are going to come forth. I know we can talk about the stages of trimester. But just in the natural sense, as my wife delivered two out of my four of my sons, without a doctor there, you too will be delivered without sometimes those around you to tell you or to even encourage you. David said, sometimes you got to encourage yourself in the moment. And brothers and sisters, this is another thing I want to point out. I noticed, I took observation of my wife's pregnancy, is that the last pregnancy, Micah, here at Stanford Hospital, the nurses were astonished at the fact that she didn't ask for any medication. No epidurals. Was breathing on her own, doing her own breathing techniques. And yet, when she delivered the baby, the doctors and nurses came back to her and said, you have done so well. You ought to teach a class. I'm going to close with this, y'all. I've never took on. Listen. There will be some people in your life in the spiritual realm that's going to look to you as you give birth to your gifts to show other people how to work the gifts that God has placed inside you. Listen, you hear what I said? Sometimes there will be some of you, as in my wife in the natural, was asked to give birth in class and then show mothers how to give birth. There will be some of you that God is already positioning now to show other people how to give birth to their spiritual gifts inside. Listen, God, we thank you now for this time of sharing. We thank you for this word. We thank you for this series, God, how you blessed us to be able to see and hear from you. Now, God, we thank you, God, for what we've heard, what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard. Now, we pray now that for those who are not saved, those who are not saved, those who don't have a church home, that they might again hear your voice. And they might come crying out, what must I do to be saved? God, we thank you for those who will watch this from near and far. But God, we thank you now for those who are in the process of birthing spiritual gifts inside of them. God, whatever it is, we pray that you continue to cover them, that they may not abort what's inside of them, but God, that they might continue looking to you, who is the author and finisher of your faith. God, we thank you for this word. Bless us now and keep us. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Thank you again for watching and tuning in. We pray blessings upon each of you in the days of life. And then we give this benediction, and then we're going to hear our theme song for the rest of the year. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the sweet holy communion, may it rest and abide with you both now and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen. Come on, God loves you. I love you. Grace and peace is my prayer until we meet again. And we're going to meet on Wednesday for Bible study and on Sunday in the parking lot. And I can't wait. We're going to have a word for you in the parking lot. Come on, as we leave this place, step before your presence. We're going out. Pastor Mike Jr. is going to be big. Come on, God bless you. As we now here celebrate, it's going to be big.